like sea time.
Okay. Dennis, would you take it? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let's have a real quick prayer with everything that happened in Connecticut.
Yes. Holy Father, we come before you today with sad hearts for what's occurred in Connecticut. Lord, those families, we ask you to be with each one of them. Give them your comfort. Lord, we ask for this kind of blessing upon this country, that, Lord, you may calm the souls that need calming, that you may be there for them. Now be with us throughout this day, and may our actions be yours. In Jesus' name,
amen. Advocate notice pursuant to the Open Public Meeting Act has been given of this meeting by forwarding notice to today's Sunbeam and the Ellen Times, by posting notice on the bulletin board in the Salem County Courthouse and the County Administration Building, and by following notice in the Office of Salem County Clerk and the Clerk Board, all have been done at least 48 hours in advance. Roll call, please.
Don't X out your
go up to the top of the screen and they close and don't X out.
Right, yeah, don't X out because that'll take you out of the admin program.
Current budget total page, is that one?
We're under budget prep worksheet.
Yes, all right. Yep, where's our, you'll see it.
At the top of the screen, if it closes back, go back and set up one.
Okay, we can do this.
Do a count range? We will keep it up.
Yeah.
It's, you just leave it open, everything.
Yeah, but print and count comments.
Count range.
Budget sequence.
You're not closing that.
Yeah. Count range, just leave it.
Yeah, oh yeah, you just leave that.
Everything else is the same.
Yeah, the only thing I have to do is click on the print comments.
Now, Don, when you ask the departments to put their comments,
Yes.
if they would go back into the comments, did you get any of them back, respond to that?
Yeah, most, off the top of my head, I can't tell you who didn't do it, but for the most part, everybody went back in.
These are comments on your comments.
The sheriff did an awesome job.
Yeah, actually, I went down and told him they didn't have to do it because they were the example of how to do it.
So you gave him kudos that he had been proactive.
He had a rough week, so he, well, actually, I gave it to Lynn because.
There's a niece.
Doug, for an example, can you point out the first one that might actually show comments?
Just roll down about a quarter.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm in a different screen. I'll get to that one.
Looks like page 11 is the first comment that I see.
Page what?
Page 11 is the first turn.
Yours is page, well, here, yours is.
I love this.
Yours will.
Yeah.
But not on all of them because they insert them into the program.
Yeah, I actually don't think I took my own advice to everyone.
No.
You're going to 18?
Doug.
Yes.
Salary and wage, you said you inserted this figure.
Yes, that's right.
And the clerk reports, or in the county clerk, did you allow for an extra person?
Not yet.
No comment, no comment.
Any changes that we've had since this haven't been put in yet, so the, you know, that's why I said before, you know, payroll number, if you want to change it.
Okay, so we'll have to really note that.
Yeah.
So this is it's a full-time and a part-time.
Typically, when do we have a payroll number?
Well, typically we can do it pretty quickly, but because of the contract negotiations, we don't really know what the that number's going to come in at.
And how about surplus? What do we typically have?
Surplus, we know the, well, it depends on when they get the annual financial statement, which is due January 26th. So at the absolute latest, you would have it in January. However,
and Lee, there's the lot of them don't have comments, and we request comments. So then I would have to keep on board.
Yeah,
they're the ones that were coming.
Yeah, it's going to release the preliminary work.
Well, no. What we do is in December we do our, once we do our closeout entries, and then in January. You make the take the schedules and then start putting them together.
Doesn't Edmunds do that for you when on the closeout? Do you have time?
Well, you can, no, because the annual financial statement, the grant report, that's not, it's too big, so it's a separate schedule that actually gets attached to the annual financial statement. The annual financial statement is there.
Where do we think about page 19?
But before we jump into that, I just to give you some an overall picture of where things are. Payroll projections right now, as I told you last time, because we don't have contract settled it and all that, the only thing we could do was to put it in at the current rate. Because in July of 12, the progression kicked in for people who get that, and then the union contracts that had the steps, that's when the steps kicked in. So the payroll is actually up about 0.75%, and that's because now they're getting that number that they only got from July to December, now it's projected for the whole year. So, but again, that number is going to change, you know, as the contracts get settled.
But there's no steps this July because all the contracts are up before then?
Well, all the contracts are up, so when I did the initial projections, I just used what I had, which just straight through for the whole year.
Okay. So unless you eliminate steps, there's still going to be steps this coming year.
There will be, but that's why I said I just took it to a base number. And it's not to say, I'm not insinuating that there aren't going to be steps or anything like that. I just want you all to know that in this initial projection, that it's just, if you're making $20 an hour on January 1st, these projections show that you're making $20 an hour on December 31st. So it is very based now. The projected overtime is in the system. That's part of it. It's not with no one getting overtime. We do have overtime projections as part of it.
That's budgeted overtime.
Right. The departments, their OE request, you know, their wish list is what you have overall. There's about a 7.5% increase over the 2012, which, as I said last time, that everybody worked really well in putting their request together. Usually that's a much higher percentage. So, and we have it broken out by department. If anybody is interested in having that, we'll certainly print that off for everyone. But for the most part, everybody came in pretty good. The big jump is obviously the capital improvement fund, because the request came in at almost $4 million, where in 2012 it was only $733,000. So it's a 438% increase in the capital improvement fund.
Thanks, Doug.
No problem.
And, you know, we really have to look at that because we do want to maintain what we have, but yet we don't want to, there's the difference between Bob's best phrases, the needs and the wants. You have to maintain some.
The capital improvement fund's been, for the last several, about 2 or 3 years, it's been really cut down.
It's been cut down, but we bonded a lot.
The storms, you know, did create quite a bit of bonding, and you've got another $400,000. That's going to have to be accounted for in 2012, at least a third of it in 2013 for the emergency appropriations that were just under the last meeting. We have to pay a third back.
And you commented that may or may not be included in the past bonds?
Can't, no. Because the past bonds were specific to Hurricane Irene and the August 14th storm in 2005. So, can't. You, not that you can't use funds from there, but it would take a resolution.
Okay.
I mean, if it had been more generic, you could just charge it off if there's funds there. You could just start charging.
Most of those came in less. The projects came in less than this.
With that kind of dollar amount, usually, because the engineering, they always kind of estimate high, just to be safe.
Do we know the number? What's left over?
I don't have that here, but they're not done. Projects aren't done.
Well, I guess it's going to be in probably the $2 million range.
So I would speak with bond counsel and the auditors and just do the appropriate resolutions and then get a good understanding of how that's going to be treated in the next budget, because by statute, that $400,000 has to be paid back over the next 3 years.
That falls under the same policy, Doug, as long as it has the same life expectancy and everything else, or the same type of use.
It's not, well, if you're going to use the bond money, which it would, because it's It's road damage.
Do you need that resolution this year?
No.
Why don't we call John?
No, you would probably do it in January, but we could certainly reach out to him prior to then and make sure. But it's definitely would. You don't need a resolution to move the funds. Let me give that some thought before I speak. Right now, it's going to be a deferred charge going forward. We would, you know, probably be, again, I'll call them, but off the top of my head, I'd have to say, probably by, for at least at the closeout meeting, to do a the resolution to move money from that bond over to this.
So one. That would be this calendar year then?
Right.
Okay, and you'll get with Evan and
Would you mind maybe handling via email to bond council?
Sure.
And copying the admin team?
Absolutely.
But we can do it by in the closeout meeting, right? It doesn't have to be by Wednesday.
No, you can. Your closeout meeting's regular, unless I don't understand the whole closeout meeting. I mean, I know what we do at the closeout meeting generally, but I think it's a regular meeting.
Or any other
business. So I don't see why you wouldn't be able to do that. And then basically, what that would do would relieve you from having to include a third of that $400,000 in the 2013 budget as a deferred, okay. As a deferred charge.
Okay. You want to get, now it's IT, right? Calendar IT? Because actually when Dennis, so then Dennis would leave, I guess, after we talked about his. Because I was under the understanding that everybody's computers, if they got new computers, was all going through IT.
They're supposed to purchase?
The purchase of computers.
The purchase of computers.
Because when you go through all these accounts, it looks
even
like...
Even if they're, if someone's putting in... requesting funds to buy a computer, there you go. If they're asking for $1,000 to buy a laptop, you just knock it right out of their request because...
But how do you know that, because it's just under computers, how do you know it's a laptop and not... Now, cartridges and everything, that goes under their own line item?
Yes.
Yeah. Doug can explain that better, but I remember last year there was... there was a misunderstanding of what went to admin supply, or what it went into supplies, is my correct, Doug? And then what went to computer stuff?
Right.
Right? So
and they still don't.
So, okay, so they still don't understand that, you know, even though it's a computer cartridge, it's part of admin, it should have went into admin supplies.
Supplies.
Right, supplies. But I think they misconstrued it and put it in under computer.
So, I mean, we're looking at equipment.
The sub account was set up. I set up before I was here, but the way it's set up, it's for equipment, not supplies.
Right, and we were just trying to get it all under one roof so that we had the same system.
Well, and the problem we were having, they were going out buying their own computers and coming back and finding out it wasn't as compatible with our system.
Yeah.
So we said to them, okay, if you need a computer, it gets bought to the IT department. Mm-hmm. That way IT has, they're
well,
the ones
who
have
inventory, and we also know who's got newer stuff and who doesn't.
He has oversight.
Yeah.
Dennis has that. Now, Board of Elections, I would assume, is that a different animal? Because they have their...
They could have computer purchases because it might be election.
Yeah.
The same thing...
The polling equipment.
Right. The same thing with...
Sheriff and prosecutors?
And the county clerk.
Okay, because they have their own system that they have to maintain.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And that answers that question. But I think there were some other ones that had computers. Okay.
Well, can we, I mean, obviously we can't fix it for this year, but we've got to make it so that they understand for next year. We can fix it this year. They don't understand it. We can fix it, but they've got to understand it for next year, so that we don't have to keep fixing it.
And we had a class, and everyone received a printout saying, if this sub account, these are examples of what go under it.
Okay, for IT, are we starting?
That's your ball game.
Okay, so for under IT.
Is that like page 19?
Yeah.
Yeah, 19 going into 20.
Admin had a presentation from IT for these two big upgrades and equipment. And we've talked about putting them under the bins, taking out a loan out for them.
Okay.
Over a three.
Well, we talked about lease purchase is what we talked about. And
and
on no yeah. Just lease purchase,
okay.
Which is, you know, entirely different. And everything that I have seen, it can be done. So we'll firm that up before we pull the trigger. But
working on the numbers right now.
As soon as
PCN, I got them working as fast as they can.
Good.
To come in and get all the numbers ready, because I need to get specifics, because when you're going to do a lease purchase, you need to have everything.
Right, that's exactly right. Right.
So they're working on getting everything down to the last wire.
And the firm that they brought with them that threw the rate out there, that rate was high based on what I've seen.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, it was extremely high based on what I've seen.
It was produced competitive.
I mean, I think that's what we have to do. We have to put it out for competitive bid, and I'm sure.
It's about $575,000.
But a lease purchase is different than a bond, so.
And we could do it over 3 years, so actually we'll be in good, four years.
Four, because we actually save, annually we would save, because of the lease purchase arrangement.
Yeah.
It would be less than the budgetary line, so. It would actually save us money.
And it's being good stewards, because this has to be done.
Yep.
And we're not keep on kicking the can down the road. We're phasing it in. And then at the end of that 4 years, we'll have to keep on doing it again.
That's by the reality.
Yes.
Now, this upgrades to Windows 7. Windows 8 is all over the place, but they said that's not...
It's not business ready yet.
It's still in the oven. It's not business.
Well, if we do a lease purchase, will that be part of it? That any upgrades will become part of it?
Oh, okay.
Yes, indeed.
Yes.
Yeah, that's my fault.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, yes.
Okay. Everybody comfortable with that? Mm-hmm. Over 4 years? Where's you comfortable
yes,
with that?
Yes, ma'am. Dennis, when was the drop dead date? When is the main, when are they doing away with support for the old program?
2014, April 2014, Windows XP goes away.
We can take that out of budget.
And as I said, we don't want to be the last one.
No.
Yeah.
We'll get more expensive as it gets
older. This is purchase part of it.
Once we firm everything up, we still have to be absolutely certain that we can lease purchase. So there's still a couple questions on this. I wouldn't do it now, but I think it's something that could be done.
Well, they got $315,000 and I guess $260,000 or both.
Are they?
$575,000, so we can take about 70% of that off.
Mm-hmm. And then go over 4 years.
Right.
Well, that number of times.
So you take about $400,000 off.
I said 25 to 4 years.
Correct.
I say 70.
Well, you say, yeah, you got to. There's interest in the top, and there's usually a little bit more up front for administration, and they know you a little bit for.
Unless you get a good bid.
But these comfortably you can take $400,000 off that.
Yeah, because the lease purchase rates that I have seen for 4 years have been around the 1.2 range. Not the 2.83, I think, that we saw.
You know, you got to calculate, you always calculate high, and then you find out what it is. So that's the way it works.
What preliminary you said this past week, we'll have to see lower rates than that.
You just want to go out and buy.
I think 400,000 is conservative. You can probably take more, but that's 400,000 is conservative. Again, a number to work with.
Now, did everybody look at their budget books? Do you guys have questions on prior stuff that we had talked about?
All right, go ahead.
We're going to keep going through.
Dennis, you have in there IT tech training. Is that for you and your staff?
Correct.
Everything else is in-house. You'll be training.
Yes.
In-house our employees.
Correct.
Who charges you the $10,000? Microsoft or?
It depends on what companies we go with. There's different types of training that my staff is going to need for this Windows 7 upgrade. They need to be trained in Windows 7. And then if and when the infrastructure goes through, there's going to be training that needs to be done on that.
Can that also be included in a lease purchase? Yeah, because that's what we were questioning. I don't know.
I don't think training can be. The question was whether software can be, but I believe software can be if it's bought at the same time the equipment is purchased.
Right. So we want to include everything that we can so that it can be spread out.
Right, but I don't think training is.
Dennis, any part of that include the issues that we're having out at the OEM, like with the servers? Having to run out there and reset the servers,
That's part of the infrastructure upgrade. A lot of things will be changing where a lot of dependencies at the OEM will go away. They will sit here at the courthouse.
Okay, very good.
Okay. Everyone good with IT?
Yeah.
The adjuster's office is next up on the list. Page 22.
Can we find out what year we're doing that thing again with the adjuster? Is that every 4 years?
Yeah. Approximately every 4 years.
Right, so we don't have to budget that yet. So if it's every 4 years, do we need a full-time person in there?
No, I think we just hire a part-time for that year.
We hired a part-time person. She stepped in beautifully and handled it. She combined some things for them, and they did a great job.
Then she got a job with the board and she could stay in the county. But there is a full-time person in there. Yes, one full-time employee. Not the secretarial support, this is the business person. Okay, so we still need a full-time person in there? Yeah, because the adjuster won't.
I think it was because they had never handled the duties. They had always subbed it out to different counties that were covered for them. And when the visitor put them on the spot and said, hey, Salem County, you're going to do it this time, I think they were kind of like a new world. So they handled it well. And I don't think it was a tremendous impact budget wise. A part time employee getting through the process for a year and then it would be great.
We had bumped up their request quite a bit. You can see on page 22, asking for $50,000 for the, that's the main thing they do is the inpatient medical. Mm-hmm.
Why was that bumped from 18 to 50?
They just seem to think they're going to need more this year. They made this type of request last year,
and
we cut it down. Well.
Did you say, Doug, when they put in a high figure of the year that they did they handled the business issue?
Right, and then they kept that high.
And then they just keep it there.
They keep the request up there.
Right.
And, this might not happen.
Right now.
It was 18, and then they wanted
Well, by the time they submitted their budget, they had, let's just say, 18,000.
Right.
And that was in October.
And that'll go off some, and those bills tend to trickle in late, too. So even into... into 2013, they'll be receiving billing for that. It's going to be an area you want to keep an eye on as possible reduction, at least. It's another one of those great unknowns. All you can do is look at the historical information and see what they've been doing. We did like road across just so we had the 1 year where they really got drilled, but that was kind of like a blip on the screen, and it hasn't gone to those kind of numbers again. So
they didn't.
You're not going to balance your budget on it.
Is it their responsibility to put in the actual 2010 and 11? There's nothing. I'm looking at the correct line item.
There's nothing.
there's nothing there, so we can't even look at historical data.
That's, if you go, you have to go down to miscellaneous on page 23, because they were, it was all getting dumped in miscellaneous. And so in 2010, it was 48,000. And 2011, it was 19,000.
So what year did we ask to clean up the miscellaneous and start breaking that down? Was that 10?
No, I think it was just last year.
Oh, no, every year.
It's been a couple of years.
We work on them every year. And there are some departments that are going to have some type of miscellaneous, just because it gets to the point where how many sub-accounts are you going to give them? You know, so you want to have a little bit of miscellaneous, but on the smaller departments, there's really...
Let me ask you, how efficient would it be to have offices in the Fifth Street Plaza to share, like, copiers? Because I've seen a lot of copier rent.
And make them walk.
No, really, we should have...
But we really got to think about it, because it's going to be time. People would go into somebody else's office, they'll be, you know... but they're not...
Here's what's going to happen. You're going to have the health department tell you how all their confidential stuff, so they need theirs.
Okay.
County clerk's office,
Okay.
Not that you're not going to be able to do it to a certain extent, but not... In the perfect world, that's what you would do.
I'm seeing board of taxation, $2,300 for copy of rent. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure the adjustress has a similar line item.
Yeah, the smaller departments that aren't as sensitive, I mean, it's basically the Board of Taxation. That's all public record. So there's nothing really too confidential, I would think. And I don't want to speak for John, but, I mean, they may have some issues that have to be, but, you know, then they can have a desktop printer if they need it.
Okay.
Dennis, were you all part of setting those things up in the new building? I mean, did you see areas that can be condensed?
When you try to consolidate printing, you have to look at how the office space is made. If you had a big open area, for instance, like the health department, big open area, you could throw a multifunction machine, copy printer, fax, right there. Okay, so people get up and can walk to a common area. But like the adjusters, I've seen where the adjusters are sitting. There's nothing common about that area.
Right.
They'd have to walk out of their office, right, to walk in. We'll just say walk into elections, because it's right across from them, to get something printed. I'm not going to say it's inconvenience, but it's a real pain to go get that information. That's all. It just depends on how the building is situated.
I guess they only had one, they use it, wouldn't they?
I'm sorry?
If they only had one, they'd use it.
No, they buy printers. They would buy printers, and then the cost of printing something from a printer on the average is 38 cents for a page, color page, and then 17 cents for a black and white. Whereas if you print something from the multifunction machine, Doug can verify this, it's less than a penny for a black and white,
seven
and about
cents.
7 cents for a color. So you can see the difference there.
Buying color printers?
We don't buy color printers. The department buys color printers. Get it right.
Okay. People are buying printers.
We don't need
the health department has a lot of color printers. The jail is very good on keeping color to a limit. I believe they have one or two multifunction machines that actually print color. Otherwise, they're black and white. The sheriff is the same way. But the amazing thing about color printers, you can default them to print black and white. And that has to be done at the top level. And it's a change. And people don't like change because they're always used to seeing color, nice pretty colors. But it's a change that if somebody says, we need to default them to black and white, then I can default them to be printing black and white. So they have to select color.
And they should be, because the way the contract's written for these leases, every single color copy is 7 cents. The black and white, you have an amount of copies built into that contract. So the first, say, 250,000 copies are already built into what you're paying. But with the color, you hit the color.
So you know, you need authorization from us?
In Everin's office, there's a color printer, but that one is defaulted to black and white. If you want color, you have to go up there and manually change it.
Well, let's do it.
Different color.
I think we should do it.
Yeah, I just don't see.
Can you do that? Sense.
Okay. I live in a black and white world. Everin will draw something
up. I would think that all Everin has to do is tell everybody. This is what's going to happen. I don't think you need a resolution from the board.
They're not going to do it themselves.
No, it can be done at a centralized, at my level, at the centralized level, the administrative level.
Let us know when you hit that button.
Yeah.
So we know not to answer the phone.
I can make it happen right now.
Yeah, okay.
I think it's too late.
It's all right, I'm just saying.
Media Central.
It was implied, it was a statement.
I agree, there should probably be one color copier in every department, maybe, or somewhere so that they can get color.
They'll use up all the time then.
Well, use up that timer. But it's not set. The default is black and white.
So it prints default to black and white, correct?
I don't think that's amounting to anything, amounting to a couple of color cards. We had to eliminate the printers, so that's what we have to do, not put it to black and white. I mean, we got to get rid of some of the printers. That's what we're talking about eliminating, right?
Absolutely, sir.
All right, well, just put them black and white. Well, we did something, we didn't do nothing. What's that amount to? Printing nothing? If we go to the health department, we say, well, all your printers, we want them all. Bring them in here, all your copies, printer. Use that one in the middle of the room there. And they go out and buy another, we're just going to take it again. They just can't keep on, don't we run the show?
If that won't cut down the number of copies, there's just going to be more demand on that one printer.
And they're cheaper.
Because the cartridges.
Yes.
And I thought we were looking
at. And didn't you say a penny a copy instead
versus
of 2 or 3 cents?
Seven
yeah.
Cents.
Less than a penny a copy.
That's
for black and
white. That's what you're trying to see, not a couple of bottles of colored ink. Trying to get rid of the printers altogether. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, do we own the printers?
Everybody owns a printer, yes. You buy the printer outright.
We put them in and sell them. Sell them to the county, sell them. And then you use this printer. That's the point we're trying to get to, isn't it?
But remember what our initial statement was. Where do you put the multifunction machines? You know, we brought up the adjuster's office, for instance. You know, the adjuster needs a multifunction machine because it's
tax maps.
They're going to have to go out to elections to get to print something to
it. I understand. I mean, right. The office here, they're not going to walk over to the Fifth Street Plaza and print something. I understand.
Right.
But all those people in that building, you're going to use one. Is that correct?
Yes.
I mean, you talk about confidentiality with the health department. Well, they go down and make printed it. Everybody's not going to flock up and say, hey, what are you printing? I mean, you know, come on.
I totally agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, really.
I totally agree with you. Confidentiality is not an issue. That was actually explained to us. Buy a RICO rep where you could push in, you could send the print job to the multifunction machine and it will not print until you put in your code.
There you go.
And then it prints.
Almost like a school. All the teachers come down to that one room.
Absolutely.
And do their print.
Except for the school where she has her own printer. Do I say that?
So that's what you want to do.
Are there laws, though, that make you have to have one?
That works for me.
What did you say, Bob?
There's a HIPAA law that in the medical profession that you can't.
Well, I think that's what you're saying. When you walk up to it, it'll store it in the copier printer, and then when you enter your,
right.
That's the
solution to that.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's
what we did. What we did earlier this year, we talked about consolidation and streamlining how our offices and departments do their business. We talked about, let's say that we were a department of one, and everybody here at the table had their own printer. You didn't really need that, so you have one printer in that room that we all can go send our information to. The Board of Taxation is just two people, so they would, you know, have their own. But you have, how many departments do you have over there? 4 or 5 different departments? And you could have, you know, six people, you know, have a printer behind them, why not just have one? We talked about consolidating that. There was significant pushback. And the team that I had in place to, you know, to review this, that was our recommendation. I have not followed up to see if, you know, if they actually conform to that recommendation. It sounds like something we can look at again.
Okay.
Let's put that
in the forefront again. Especially now we have that building and, you know, I don't know, you know, all the different areas, not only just that building, you know, all the buildings.
What we have to do is we have to take a little action. We do the same discussion every year, just bad, and then it's just, it just goes away. Nothing ever happens.
Okay.
We have to take some action. We did the same hour discussion about printers and copiers last year, and here we are talking about it this year.
Dennis, you say Rico is who you use?
Yes, sir.
Why wouldn't we just have them come in and analyze the situation?
They did.
And make recommendations?
They did.
Okay.
The Rico rep came in and did that.
Okay.
Specifically for us. They told us we had the best deal ever on color copies and prices. They turned around, they recommended that we get everything changed to black and white.
You're having the guy that shows us up to us, telling him what we got?
Yes.
That's very nice.
Well, it doesn't mean we, but I mean, these are the experts as far as laying out the flow of information.
Yeah.
And you need some type of
that's like you
individual
come in, you come and bring your car and ask me if you need a tune-up. Absolutely you need a tune-up.
No. They weren't trying to sell us. They weren't trying to sell us any more multifunction machines.
We don't need any. We got too many now. That's what we're trying to do.
We're trying to analyze the compare printers and multifunction machines.
They said the default of the black and white.
One of the recommendations was the default everything to black and white. Reduce the number of printers, move the multifunction machines into a centralized position. They weren't trying to tell us that we need another tune-up, but I understand what you were saying, but they came in to actually analyze how we were doing it. And honestly, they walked away saying, you're doing the best thing you can do. Here are some other recommendations. They didn't say we needed more multifunction machines, though we may be able to find out that we may need some just to, if you're gonna reduce printers, you're going to have to give them either a centralized printer, which I thought about, or a multifunction machine that's going to be able to do the copying. Remember, the multifunction machine does a lot of copying, but lots of times these people just want you print. So maybe there's a centralized printer we put in, not a multifunction machine. Because a lot of these departments do have some high-speed, high-production printers. And in that, we could take that out of somebody's office and move it into a centralized position where it can handle, you know, the 100,000 copies that it needs.
I would just like to come in here next year at this time and see some meaningful change.
Gotcha.
Okay.
That's what I'd like to say next year.
Yeah.
Instead of the same talk again.
Yeah. And all this change is going on right now would be appropriate time.
Let's see.
To go ahead and get that mindset right. Okay. So you'll get some?
We will work on that.
Good.
And
thanks.
Kevin, again.
Okay.
We had a plan. We presented it. I know we came to the table and we got pushed back from a lot of people here.
No, I think Dennis didn't have the complete information I thought he didn't have.
There was a lot of pushback from departments.
Okay.
A lot.
Oh, okay.
Correct me if I'm wrong. And did we have somebody other than just Rico come in?
Yes.
And look at it? I thought you did. I thought there were at least two, if not three, different vendors. Next up is Board of Taxation. They're basically asking to remain the same.
What's their rent and lease? Is that, oh, that's the copy. Okay.
And you can see John didn't put anything in office computers. He put his supplies where they went. Some people do follow their sheets. You'll see, if you see that there's a salary and wage line item, because years ago they were listed as a county employee and it really wasn't the case. So at think 2009 was probably the last year they actually were listed as a, an employee. So that's why you see all zeros there. And so now everything goes under the other line, which basically right now just has a 2% increase built in. That obviously will change based on what happens with the contracts for 2013. Labor Council, same thing. I would think that you'll probably need more there. I mean, you are dealing with
negotiations,
so this would be a year, as it was, for, you know, obviously it's all started
now. But you don't have that year that we did it in here, right? That wasn't 2009, that was...
Yeah, that's not reflected.
Yeah, do you remember what that was? Because I thought we still capped it. We didn't do it out.
Oh, Labor Council?
Yeah. It was like, we don't want to give them incentive to spend money. It was a cap. You got to get it done with this. Yeah. I don't remember what happened. I mean, it's up. So I think I don't Beth, do you want to see, you want Doug to look in 2008, 2009?
Yeah,
look in the last time we did it,
because
I think we
have
it, otherwise there's...
I can look right this second, I think,
what was
that, 2000? Oh, it's right
now.
I mean, if you want to
work,
you
can
just
write
down the...
Right. But if you cap it, I guess the question I would have, if you cap it and you... They had several negotiations going on.
Well, I think they were separate.
The contract negotiations? I mean, you don't know, it's hard to say how many contract negotiation sessions you're going to have. It depends on how much progress you're making.
All right, we need the history on that.
What was that, 2001?
One second here.
The jump was here. I think it was your first year, wasn't it?
2009 was my first full year.
Now, on the Sarah training and education, she said 2012 budget reduced staff training. I didn't understand what that meant. That was page 28. I don't see that. Was it a comment?
What's the problem now?
You know what? It's on page 30 on here. Surrogate.
Sorry.
Yeah, on your, it's page 28 on your book. And it says 2012 budget, reduced staff training for $2,100. She went from 400 to 21. I didn't quite get that.
I think what she's trying to explain there is that she reduced it in 2012 and she's kind of trying to get some additional training for the folks this year. That's why there's a bump.
Okay.
Labor Council in 2009 was $40,000.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
What was that, Doug?
Labor Council in 2009 was $40,000.
Now, we probably started negotiating.
However, but wait a minute. It's probably, let me look beyond because it probably got charged to special. They could have gotten charged to special counsel.
The last meeting, there was, you had $40,000 when I saw some documentation of additional $28,000.
That's where the negotiations.
Yeah, there was
another place, another line.
There was $150,000 spent in 2009 in special counsel.
It is a broken head.
Some of
that was probably incurred in 2007.
Okay, that's right. If you want, I can drill down into that and see.
That's right.
I don't know if now's the time to do that. Yeah.
But if you can note that.
The council accounts seem to co-mingle. The county council line was always strictly for whoever your
solicitor
was. And the labor and the special counsel roll the dice to see where they don't get charged. So I kind of put those two together.
Okay, engineer. You have a lot of new accounts, I guess, because it's 2013.
They had that ability to go in and set up additional accounts, which engineering did take advantage of that ability. But she did explain. They for the size of the department, they were lacking in sub-accounts. So. Now, understand, the sub-accounts are uniform. So an account that ends in 202 or 201 in the, you know, for advertising, every department sub-account that's 201 will be advertising.
Okay.
So it's not like engineering 201 is advertising and the sheriff's office 201 is supplies.
Okay, so 202, what is that?
202, I want to say it's contracts, I would think. Yeah, 202 is contracts, 203 is dues and subscriptions. What else did they add?
207, permit fees.
207, I don't know if it's used a whole lot.
What kind of uniform requirements do we have? See, uniform allowance, $860. What was
work shoes.
I think one of the, that's one of the, not for the engineer.
OSHA.
It's for the department.
Yeah.
So